vez, Palomo. ¿En qué estamos?
What's up? I'm okay. How are you?
Why are you answering in Spanish?
I don't wanna.
This is the Bronx Project Podcast. I am host one of two.
Yes.
I'm Mirez.
And I'm host two of two. Earl Grey / Josh Valentine.
We're not doing
slash...
this. Nope.
Okay. No. Nope. We didn't let me finish my slash.
Nah, man. No slash lines.
No slash lines?
Hey.
I'm sad. Damn.
I'm excited that I finally got you to call yourself Earl Grey.
It's going
to
change.
It only took a month.
So. Now I'll remember this. Now it's going to change. You drink that beer, and I'm thinking about changing my name right now.
You sound spicy. It's almost as spicy as this beer.
The thing is, I knew that you were transitioning into the beer segment, and then
you were like, I would only hope that you'd be a little more clever.
Did you see my face expression? Like, my eyes popped up, but then I'm like, no. Oh, don't do it. God damn it.
Our The Bronx Project TBP beer of the week is Sam Adams Harvest Hefe.
Yeah, Harvest Hefe. It's mixed with, it's a wheat beer mixed with some spices, some cinnamon and nutmeg.
Some nutmeg.
To celebrate that October, November feel, you know.
For the rest of the month, we're going to be speaking on only pumpkin flavored beers.
Yeah, people have gotten confused with pumpkin flavor, thinking that pumpkin is in these flavors of beer. No, it's just nutmeg. It's flavors that you put into pumpkin shit. You know, like pumpkin spiced. Anything is literally just, you know, cinnamon, nutmeg, and allspice, some ginger. Right. People really think that someone put
some
pumpkin
puree
in that shit. Yeah, actually,
that should be chunky.
Yeah, but the serious part of this beer is that it is actually brewed with pumpkin.
Yeah?
It's wheat. And pumpkin brew.
Yeah, I was about
brewed.
To say, it's, we got to put that in there. It's a wheat ale.
Yeah.
Now, this is going to be my third time saying this. I hope you guys are taking notes.
They are.
I like wheat ales.
They're not taking notes for fun. They're just taking notes like,
like a mental note.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck, I got that one wrong.
Yeah, exactly.
I thought he liked pilsners.
Oh, shit.
But I do like pilsners. It was a trick question.
Yeah, we like beers.
Because I don't like the dark shits.
You know, like Guinness?
I hate extra stout shit. Too bitter for me.
I don't like extra stout either, but do you like just regular stout? Like, when we go into St. Patrick's Day...
I've never had, regular Guinness, bro. I've had the extra stout, and I've had the blonde.
You've never had a regular Guinness?
Never in my life.
You never sat down... I remember... I think that was just me.
It was
me.
Extra stout, bro.
No, that was just me. When we went to St. Patty's last year.
Yeah, yeah.
That was just me.
It was just you.
I had a regular Guinness
from
the drought.
I just remember this one time we were hanging out with Matt and Chris.
Yeah.
And we got some Guinness extra stouts. And I was not happy about those. Those are disgusting.
Oh, they're powerful. They are very powerful. They're actually more liquor in those beers than
that's
anything.
The kind of beer you drink when you want to punish yourself over something.
Yeah, like if you're angry about yourself.
I cheated on my girlfriend.
Oh,
I
gotta drink.
And I really I hate myself, but I don't know how to really be external about it, how to show it externally. So I'm just gonna punish myself by drinking
this nasty ass black beer.
Yeah,
it's dark.
It's disgusting.
It's the color of space. Dark, black
with white specks.
Yeah, just little white specks. Actually, true. The foam comes up, you know. But yeah, that's our beer of the week, Harvest Hefe. So
how do you feel about it? I don't think we've given opinions.
My opinion is surprising, only because I haven't had any pumpkin spice in a while. And it's been pumpkin spice has been in news lately, saying that, oh, it's only for white girls and things
I was going to say this is our version of the pumpkin spice latte, bro.
Yeah, I mean, I love pumpkin spice latte.
Yeah?
You do, too. Oh, look at me.
I've never had
a
pumpkin spice latte.
Yes, you have. All right, here we go. Remember when we used to hang out in Queens and in Brooklyn?
Yeah.
And there was that time like, yo, is there like a Dunkin' Donuts around? I want to try out that pumpkin spice latte.
Nah, bro, that was the eggnog latte.
No. We've had pumpkin spice latte also.
It was the eggnog.
And,
I'm not going to, listen, I don't care. My masculinity ain't fragile. If I like pumpkin spice lattes, I like pumpkin spice lattes. It was eggnog, though.
I feel like it was pumpkin spice. I feel like we both had pumpkin spice. And then we enjoyed it very well while we're driving back to the Bronx.
Nah, bro, because I have like a crippling fear of pumpkin. Like even when Brian
didn't notice. What? Like you just look at a fucking pumpkin and you're like, no!
No, I can't.
No!
I can't.
No! Don't do this to me. Get away!
Nah, I don't know. I just don't know what pumpkin tastes like, so I'm really skeptical about tasting shit like that. Again, you guys can't see. I say it all the fucking time. Obviously, they can't see.
They can't. This is a fucking podcast.
This is a video podcast, bro.
I know, but this is like technically like radio.
Yeah.
Recorded.
So we got the Harvest Jefes, but I also got me a blonde beer just in case I didn't like this because I was so skeptical going in.
Yeah, it's not our
beer. It's not our beer of the week.
Beer of the week. The beer of the week. But it's a blonde. Leffe?
L-E-F-F-E.
Leffe? Leffe?
Leff.
Leff. Is it French?
Yeah, I don't even know.
Is it German? It's a Belgian ale, sorry. Anyways, but that's not our beer of the week. Our beer of the week is...
Could it be Leaf?
Probably, actually. Sam Adams Harvest Jefe. So... If you're a white girl and you like your pumpkin spice like I do, try this beer out right now. Dude, people have been like degrading people who like pumpkin spice.
You sound real pressed about it.
I'm really pressed about it. Yeah, I'm angry because people are like downing people.
Like, yo, bro, let me enjoy my pumpkin spice.
Yeah, like, yo, I like myself a Starbucks pumpkin spice latte.
I hate Starbucks.
But pumpkin spice latte.
Yeah. Now, the thing is, I work at a bakery, so I get coffee for free. The idea to me of paying like $7 for a latte, that'd be fucking shit. I will not ever.
You know what? When I drink Starbucks, it's for a good time. Like, I'll have it occasionally, like once every 2-3 months. But usually, if I want my pumpkin spice, I'll make it myself from my coffee maker. I'll mix the grinds up. This is a secret ingredient, so I'm giving you some ingredients. You mix your grinds, your coffee grinds, whatever grinds you like, with some cinnamon, nutmeg. Add a little cocoa if you want, if you have some like raw cocoa. And then a little nutmeg in that bitch. And then you brew your coffee, and the aroma will spread through your house. It's really nice. It's you know, it makes you upbeat. It's really nice to drink too. It's nice to smell. So yeah. People think, oh, I'm mixing it in my coffee after it's brewed. But no, you're just, it's kind of like sitting on the top because the density of cinnamon and nutmeg don't really fall into and mix in the coffee.
Right.
So if you're trying to get yourself some pumpkin spice coffee in your life, mix it in with your ground coffee and then brew it and you'll have a good time. Don't degrade pumpkin spice. Don't. It's a good, it's
try
a good.
It.
It's
try
a try, it. You know, good. It's a
you know
good
what, after
mix.
After this episode, we can go to Starbucks, try a pumpkin spice latte.
I ain't trying it. I'm having it.
You're trying it. I already tried it.
I already tried it.
Approved.
Exactly. Approved right away.
Speaking of grinding, though, I got an axe to grind.
What?
I have an axe to grind.
I thought you said I had an ass grind.
Yes, I have an axe
like,
to grind.
You just like literally just rubbing your ass on a grinder.
No.
Okay.
I have an axe to grind.
Okay, go ahead.
With New York sports.
Oh. Yeah.
I feel like that transition was a little better.
No, it's a great transition. I'm just really upset of New York sports right now.
Yeah, we're in a shit place. We've been in a shit place. We've been in a shit place in the sense that, like, every year we're like, yeah, this is the year. Yeah, we're doing it this year. And every year, we could not be more wrong. It's frustrating. We'll have it. The tally goes Yankees fucking up in the playoffs.
Yeah.
8-9.
Oh.
8-9.
It was 8-8 into the 13th inning, and then Joe Girardi made a dumb mistake to not challenge the play with the hit by ball play. He didn't do that. We had a chance to actually win the game, but he actually confessed that it was his mistake. My bad. I'm sorry,
guys.
Actually
don't do anything, bro.
Nah, because now we're 2-0. Yeah. They're 0-2. And the Yankees falling behind 2. And then now they're coming back to New York tomorrow.
I hate when people do that shit. I hate when people, like, apologize. Like, that fixes shit.
Nah.
Like, oh, I cheated on you. I'm sorry. No, man.
The thing is, Stephen, The thing is, Miris, Steven Miris, that he was trying to defend his choice in the beginning. He was like, nah, we didn't have enough time. We didn't have enough time to challenge the play.
But we absolutely had enough
time. We had enough time to challenge the play. It would have been timeout, and then that's it. Mm-hmm. Baseball has no time. Right. You just fucking play until someone wins. You can play 15
innings.
Yes, forever. Yeah, if anything. But yeah, we fucked up.
Our hearts were torn out. Uh-huh. Then we take a trip down and go visit our Giants, who as of today are 0-5.
Yes.
After, listen, everyone was expecting, going in, everyone was like, hey, man, Giants are going to have a stellar season.
Yeah, they got Giants a good
made
team.
Some, they made some decent moves. Odell Beckham Jr. is expected to take a leap this year.
Nope.
Odell Beckham Jr. took a dive this year. A
huge dive.
Fucked his foot up.
Again. He hurt himself twice. Like, first in the preseason, right. And now in the post.
In game five.
Yeah,
today,
in game five, he hurt himself.
We're recording this October 8th, 2017.
He's crying while being escorted off the stadium, and I'm like, bro, take care of yourself. If you want to, yeah, go ahead.
To defend him though. I'd probably be crying too. I just fucked my foot up on national TV.
No, I'm not.
Listen, this man at the beginning of this season said that the elephant in the room is that he's going to be the highest paid NFL player ever.
Yeah.
That's what he said. Mm-hmm. He put that out into the universe. He couldn't have since a chance. Then, he's been injured twice. They're not going to give him max money.
No, because he's prone. Yeah. He's prone to injury, and he's prone to messing up the season.
Yeah, he's prone to... He hasn't shown the grit and the determination to be a leader at a high level yet.
You know, Giants... New York Giants have a big star team. You know, you have Eli... Yeah.
Eli Manning's Eli trash, Manning, if you ask me.
Eli Manning, but the thing is, he's getting older, so his arm is also getting older.
He's trash. Basura.
I mean, like I said, I'm not a Giants fan.
He's a Jets fan.
I'm a Jets fan.
Ignore him.
I'm a Jets fan. The worst team in New York. We're actually the best team right now.
We don't ignore. We treat the Jets the way we treat the Mets, the way we treat the Nets. You notice how they all end in ET.
Yes.
S.
Which is why you made the nice comparison.
Because they're all trash.
They're all trash. Yes, but the thing is, the Nets have been pretty much winning.
The Jets.
The Nets have been winning. The Nets have been preseason. Winning the
preseason. That's
That's another conversation. The Mets terrible. I never liked them, and I never will. The Jets, I've always liked them. They've always been terrible, but this season we might have a chance just because we have a decent young team going on.
I don't know, man. I don't know. I just feel like I hear you. I'm still stuck on you saying the Nets are doing well because they won two preseason games.
I mean, compared to the Knicks.
Okay. The Cavs lost the preseason game.
I'm just talking about the Knicks and Nets here.
I know, but you're not about to downplay my Knicks by elevating.
I love the Knicks. Brooklyn I'm Nets. A fan. Where's my hat? There's my hat right there.
There's a lot of hats.
Yeah, there's a Knicks hat.
Got like three Yankees hats and one Knicks hat.
That's how you know. I'm a Knicks fan, but at the same time, I'm a firm believer that the preseason determines pretty much a big portion of what the regular season
because
will look
Josh
like.
Is a baseball fan. But I try to explain to him that with basketball, preseason matters not because it's like a trial run. You know? You start dating a girl. And you know, okay, you don't know because you're married, but you start dating a girl, and it's the beginning of the relationship is completely different from
first of
from
all,
what
Steven,
the relationship
I've dated
is.
Girls before.
Josh, your last the last beginning of a relationship was when you were 18.
Exactly. I've dated girls.
It's before. Been a while ago. Though,
I'm
25,
but I'm just saying. I've dated.
You retired, son.
Yeah.
New technologies come out.
It has. It's like still catching up.
Like you a doctor. Like, yeah, you're a doctor. You retired 50 years ago. You're dead. But like you retired 15 years ago.
Oh, I'm making
this
podcast.
You're out of contact. You're out of touch with the medical world.
I think you're out of touch with the
dating world, bro.
I mean, I don't need to.
Yeah, you don't need to be in touch with the dating world. I'm just saying,
back in the days when I was dating, I dated. Is what I'm trying to say. I dated. I'm not saying that I remember. I'm just saying there was a time.
I hear you. Okay, so the Knicks, mind you, the Jets, Mets, and Nets will not be talked about. Mm-mm. Those are not actual New York teams. Yeah, I know you're a Jets fan, but
I like the Jets. I know. We'll slip them in. The thing is, I'm a big baseball fan, so if
right.
Steven starts to degrade my Jets, I'm all right.
He's
I'm
not going right. to defend like, I'm not talking
I'm
shit
like,
about
I know there's shit.
I'm not talking shit about the Yankees. I would not talk shit about the Yankees.
You can't. You just can't.
Yeah.
Look how many hats I have.
But look at my hats, man.
Yeah, look at my hats. There's three of them back there. One of them fit, really.
Yeah?
I know two of them fits.
Fit. I like the way the Knicks hat looks on you.
Yeah, it's because it's an Adidas hat.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's why.
I was thinking about getting myself a Knicks dad hat. Strange that I don't have one. Really big Knicks fan.
Terribly big Knicks fan. That's
throwing,
the thing.
Throwing that to go back to the topic, Knicks ain't doing shit. Our young boy, Frank Ntilikina, he's been injured. He was injured all summer league. And he injured himself game one of preseason.
My baby boy.
Which is, hey, man.
Hey, no.
Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. It's preseason. The injury may not be that severe, but we're just holding him back, you know, because we don't want to risk it during preseason. No one wants to prove. What do you have to prove in preseason?
No one has to prove anything in preseason. Right. It's pretty much trying your plays.
I will say this. The Knicks will either be impressively okay or very, very bad this year. What I mean by that is maybe 80% of our roster this year is a new roster.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to take time to gel together. What that may mean is that when it does gel together, we're going to be impressed by what happens. But what it most likely means, the other Knicks are going to be bad again this year.
No, I'm agreeing with you. They're a developing team. Yeah. They have a lot of young prospects, and they're building them up to be greats. You know, Porzingis is already a star within a lot of New York eyes, and even impressive within like the older NBA. Crowds. Yeah, of NBA.
The NBA looks at this man. They call him the unicorn for a reason. They look at this man. He's 7'3". He should not be moving the way. I can't even move like that, nigga. I'm 6'2".
Like, what? Oh.
It's impossible. Like, he should not be doing that.
He's Porzingis.
And he can do it.
He's Mr. Unicorn.
Yeah.
And they have a lot of young prospects. They have to build up. And I'm looking towards the future for the Knicks. They have a bright and beautiful future. Right now, I agree with you. It's not going to be the most impressive season.
I'm looking forward to the future as well. But let's talk about the past for a bit.
Go ahead.
How was your week?
It's all right. Same thing, same old, working and stuff. But I've been working out like crazy. Like, seriously.
Hitting the gym.
Yeah. The gym hardcore with my brother. And actually, yesterday, you and I and my brother, Joseph, we went to the gym for the first time together.
Took him to Blink. Josh goes to Planet Fitness with his brother Joseph.
It's affordable and it's close.
I go to Blink Fitness.
Mm-hmm, which is pretty far from me.
It's far from you. It's on my way. I take the D train
mm-hmm.
to and from work, and I also live on the D line.
Yes.
I know it sounds like there's a lot of penis jokes that he takes the D.
We're not going to talk about the D anymore. I'm just saying, do you ride the D hard?
I ride the D all the time.
Hard?
Not hard. Like, I just ride it.
Hard? You stroke a little bit?
I usually not off when I'm on the D. All
right, but do you get the D off?
I get off the D.
Okay. I just want to know.
I get on the D. I ride it for like 30 minutes.
As long as it's on
and
time.
And I get off.
And it gets you off. That's what matters.
Yeah.
Not talking about dick jokes.
No, I'm just saying. Like, I'm just saying that when I come to the place that I need to, I get off.
Yeah, of course, of course. Yeah. It's a mutual thing. Okay.
No, the D keeps going. The D is never ending.
No, it's a long ride, a long stroke of.
And you know, it is crazy because like I take the train. I have to go to work at 6 in the morning. So I wake up at 4 to 4:30. I get to the train station at around like 5:10. But you know those D's, man, they take forever to come.
Yeah, it really does.
And when it finally does come, you just like you're when you're more relieved.
When I used to take the D, it took me a while to get off, honestly.
Yeah.
Like the only time I really took the D was going to Coney Island, and that's a 2-hour ride. Man, it took 2 hours to get off.
Yeah.
The D.
Yeah.
Like that's a seriously long time, but it's been a really long time.
Has since that ever I've taken you 2 hours to get off?
Like on the D?
Like on like sexually.
I don't know. It depends how drunk I am. You know, you drunk and you're numb.
Yeah.
Have you ever fucked drunk?
Yeah.
It takes a long time. It
takes a long time.
Like, you I'm know.
Not to brag.
Like Travis Scott would say, I'm way too numb. Yeah. We don't need those condoms.
I don't think condoms are used to numb penises, though. I think they're used for sexual.
But they also numb the penis.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean,
I wouldn't know. I don't use protection.
Oh, I do. Yeah. I have to. Because I really don't want a baby.
No.
Not yet.
I believe it.
I love babies, just not now.
God got me.
Yeah. You think God got your pull-out game on spot?
Bro.
Just...
Bro. You mean that you ain't never seen a pull-out game like mine?
I haven't seen you pull out.
I know, but I'm just saying, like, if you did, if, what, like, for instance...
Like, if it was a show?
Let's just say, for whatever reason, I'm having sex and you're in my house.
Yep. Yep.
And for whatever reason, I'm about to come, and you open my door.
Yeah.
I'll still pull out in time.
No,
like,
you
the
will.
Surprise of someone...
Like, you're like, oh, shit, Josh, what's up? Wait, hold on.
Yeah.
All right, so what do you want to talk about tonight?
Yeah. And then I'll continue with the conversation. It's rude. That's rude not to.
Yeah, exactly. You don't want to just neglect me.
I don't want to neglect
like, I'm like, Steven, pull out. You think... some people, I feel like they need a coach to pull out.
Yeah?
Because it's way too often that men don't pull out.
You know, I don't think... Listen, hot take. I truly believe that when niggas don't pull out, they make a conscious decision in their head like, yo, fuck it.
Like, fuck it, I'm just gonna...
I have never... Bro, I have never in my life been having sex and I'm like, oh shit, I'm about to come. And I couldn't like acknowledge the point where it was about to happen and pull out. It's never happened. Like, that's not even a skill I had to like develop much.
No, not at all.
I lost my virginity when I was 15.
Mm-hmm.
Then I knew, I was like, oh.
Like, oh shit, what's that feeling? Yeah, I gotta take it out.
I gotta
go. Yeah, seriously. I mean, I've never messed up on a pull-out job ever, because there's not all the time where I use protection.
So, ladies, a nigga come inside of you, he meant to.
Yeah, I feel like he really wanted to plant his seed inside of you. Just not because he wants a baby, just because it kind of feels better to just jizz in the girl.
Oh, like, that's another thing. Have you ever?
Yes, I mean, with a condom on, but still, even so.
I've done it.
It's like godly.
Yeah.
It's God-sent. Yeah. Like, God... made that jizzing inside of a woman with anything. Just jizzing inside of a woman is just an amazing job. It's just,
I once came jizzing. Inside of a
How
girl
old am I?
As she was also coming. And then, like, you know, when a girl comes, that is like the squeezing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The contractions.
Yeah, of the vaginal walls. And holy Jesus. Like, if I became a father at that time, I'd be straight with it.
Yeah, it's like, you know, it was worth it.
Yeah, it was worth it. It was. She was on birth control. That's the only reason why I ejaculated inside of her. But had she not been on birth control and I slipped up, I did the air quotes because, again, like I just said, I don't think you could slip up. I feel like that's a conscious decision.
Honestly, I've never ever came inside of a girl in my entire life. I've never made that mistake. I've always thought about what if, and I feel like my semen is too potent.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like if I did jizz inside of a girl, regardless if she's having birth control or not,
you feel
that's
like
a baby.
You feel like your nut is going to supersede.
Like, my nut is genetically created
the
medicine create
that
babies.
Is birth control?
Yeah.
Like, it's going to rip through the birth
control
wall.
Yeah, it's like, it just looks at birth control and just punches it right in the throat.
Where that fucking egg at?
Yeah, like, tell me now! Where's the egg?
Where's Rachel?
Where's Rachel? Tell me where's the trigger? fucking Batman negotiating his way to the egg. That's, I feel like, that's why I've never, ever in my life ejaculated in a girl without using a condom.
Does your nut have a utility belt?
I feel like my nut has all the utilities.
Yeah?
Yeah, it just calls the Batmobile over.
Good shit. So that's how usually how your nut would break through the wall, right? It has a Batmobile.
Yeah, it just
hits the turbo. Yeah. Oh, because it got those fucking missiles.
Exactly. Exactly. It breaks through those walls. Oh, and shit. And then it's like, it just drips inside the egg.
I love how we're talking about semen. And we know that, like, most of the people who listen to our podcast are women.
Yeah. Actually, yeah.
Yeah. That's...
And they listen to us for a reason. Talk. Yeah. I mean, have you ever heard a man talk about jizz so much?
Yeah, I'm sure they have. I'm sure every single person that's listening to this podcast,
we're two guys. Too many. We're going to talk about jizz. We're going to talk about the flavor of jizz when pineapple... reaches. Have you ever ate coconut and then jizz inside of a woman and then ask her how that
no tastes? But I okay, so mouth, I work at a bakery.
Okay.
I'm gonna keep saying that every while.
Steven, we work in a bakery.
So I drink and eat a lot of pineapple. Pineapple is an ingredient that we use a lot in the bakery that I work in.
I wish I was there.
No, you don't.
I mean, I wish I was there eating.
Josh,
I wish I was just that guy that just ate the food.
Look at me in my eyes. No, you don't. It's hell.
Okay.
But yeah. I see dead people.
Damn. Go ahead.
Yeah. So I work at a bakery. Eat and drink a lot of pineapple.
Mm-hmm.
So I have what I believe to be the sweetest semen in the world. Has it been confirmed? I don't know. Can it be confirmed?
It could.
No, because I've asked, like, my girlfriend at the time. I don't have a girlfriend anymore.
Single Steven. Long walks on
it's
the
all, It's actually super depressing because... No, guys. Guys, you should feel bad for me.
And don't feel bad for him.
No, no, please. Please do. Please pray for me.
If you know somebody, some nice girl, some nice Jewish
girl. No, stop it. Stop it, Josh. I will not whore myself out.
I'm not. I'm just
You're
saying.
You're whoring me out.
I'm putting you on advertisement.
No.
This is our fake advertisement.
I got this, bro. Nah, but... No, my ex would say that it's the pineapple makes it a lot less bitter. I don't know about coconut, but I know the pineapple makes the bitterness go away. I don't think there's anything you can really do to make your semen taste good. But from my understanding, the problem with semen is that it's like battery acid.
I heard it's...
And it takes away that feeling away.
I heard it's salty, that's all.
Yeah, well, yeah, I don't know. I'm not coming into my own mouth.
Neither am I.
So I don't know what it tastes like.
Last time
like.
I came, it went in my. It just hit me.
Have
in the
you
face
ever come
mistake.
In your mouth?
Nope. Almost.
Yeah.
Yep.
I did by mistake once.
It reached real high.
I was like, I know I've told you the story, but I haven't said it to the pod, yep. To the cast.
Yep.
Stroking.
Yeah.
And I'm going to Pound Town. I'm going there.
Yeah.
I'm out there. I'm out here with like, scout gear.
Yeah, you're like on three laps and you're about to make it.
And so I'm about to ejaculate as it goes.
Watch, if guys, I wish you saw this because his left hand is moving up and down, simulating the jerk off. And I'm watching him, but the way he's talking about it is just his hands going up and down. And I'm like, yeah, Steven. Uh-huh.
So, you know, just,
now I know his grip.
It's
kind of like a guitar solo.
It really is. I leave my thumb off always. And then the thumb I use to like, okay, so hold like that. The thumb I use to kind of like rub the head.
That's some.
It's masterful work, bro. Masterful work.
I'm impressed.
I'm telling you. Oh, but what was learning. I saying?
The way I jerk off.
Oh, you're about to jerk off. I'm out here. I'm jacking it. I'm jacking it. I'm going at it. And I come and I'm like, like, you know, sometimes you come and you make, like, you're like,
Yeah?
Yeah, like, okay. So not every sounds. Orgasm is created. Yeah, not every orgasm is created.
It's mine.
Sometimes you get those OD powerful ones.
And you're like,
Yeah, I mean, not that.
We're like,
All right, so for the sake of conversation, I was right, and I'm jacking it, and my shit shoots up, dang, mad high, and lands on my lip.
Oh, that happened. That happened.
That shit just.
No, that happened. That happened to me too. I was just. I don't know why. It's been a while. At the time, I was just like neglecting my penis. And then I'm like, you know what? Today's the day. And I'm just like stroking it. And Steven looks at my hand. This is how I jerk off. I'm just stroking it.
You jerk off like you hate your penis.
Yeah. You're like, man, it owes me money. That's how much I hate it.
Beat my dick like it owes me money.
Yeah. And then out of nowhere, I'm like, oh, shit. And I'm watching something really good. And then just.
How much money? Sorry. Just finish the story, but I just want to ask you a question right now before I forget it. How much money would a person have to owe you before it's okay to beat them?
$5,000. No, $20. $20.
I once owed a pod theater $10, and I felt really uncomfortable
like
around him.
Yeah.
I kind of thought he was going to beat me up, but like.
You just know that that man is just.
I owed him $10, and like when you owe someone money.
It's like a little empty slot.
Yeah.
Like a health bar, but your health bar is like just slashed off a little bit.
It's like he knows. Like he can see my health bar.
Yeah, you can see my health bar, see how weak I am. See how much
I need.
You
owe me $10, you bitch boy.
Anyways, I never owed anyone money in my life. But my dick owed me a lot of money. Yeah. And that time, I don't know, it just went boop. That's the sound effect. And it just went right in the sky.
Like a penny falling into a fountain.
And it was so slow motion. I just watched it. And there was some Italian opera playing in the background. Just falling towards my face.
Requiem for a Dream.
Yes. Ding, 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 ding. And it just hits. Ding, 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 ding. And it hits my lip. But at the same time, it also hits my eye.
Oh no. Pink eye.
Pink eye.
I remember this.
Yes. Yes. Oh, we had a sleepover.
Yeah.
And I'm like, God, Steven. No.
This nigga Josh got the pink eye.
Cause I jizzed
from his own semen.
I jizzed in my own eye. And I thought it was funny to share.
And we it was a moment of shared humiliation.
Yeah. I feel like.
Because Josh.
Yeah.
Prior to this was used to make fun of me a lot. When I was, I want to say 16, my girlfriend at that time and I were engaging in intercourse. And yes. She's like, hey, come in my mouth. But like, I'm already about to come as I'm pulling out. So I'm like holding the head of my dick, trying to make it to her mouth. My shit just shoots out on the way there, catches her in her eye.
Oh. Yeah, I remember this story. Yeah,
I know you remember this story, because for the next, like, 4 years, this nigga would not.
You.
Yeah.
Because that was an extraordinary event. You have to understand that I've never done that at the time. I lost my virginity at 17, like, when I turned 17, like, right out of the day.
That was a good birthday present.
Yeah, it was nice. Anyways, I never heard of such a thing. And then Steven telling me this, I'm like, that is extraordinary. How do you just miss like that? It's right. Your penis is like there. Like
I didn't even tell you the story. She told you the story.
Yeah.
I remember it vividly.
I remember talking to her.
In a KFC.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, we were in a Kentucky Fried Chicken. Kennedy Fried Chicken.
Oh, yeah.
For people who live in the Bronx or who live in New York. I don't know.
If you live in New York City, you know what a Kennedy Fried Chicken is.
I don't know what niggas got in Brooklyn and shit. I'm
pretty sure they have a Kennedy Fried Chicken.
But yeah, so we was in a Kennedy. And she's like, hey, Josh, I got to tell you a story. And I'm looking at her with the eyes like, don't. Please.
She tells me anyway.
And for the next 4 years, Josh just lets his karma, his bad karma build up and build up and build up by making fun of me. Just take your shots, Josh. Take your shots because you don't know what's going to happen to you.
In fact, it did happen to me and...
Of your own doing, own eye.
Yeah, it wasn't like I was trying to jizz on somebody's face. It was like... I was just trying to jizz, but the thing is the power that my balls and penis had...
Yeah.
It just went shot right out of my dick. and went straight up, and the projection, for some reason, just landed right on my face. And I had pink eye for half that day.
I remember that.
Yeah, I had to take my contact off.
We were having a sleepover.
Yeah, and I had to squeeze the red eye stuff.
Visine?
Yeah, Visine right into my eye. That didn't work.
Yeah. I can't imagine Visine has much applicable uses for cum.
Yeah, I realize how strong my semen is. And that's when I'm coming back to the segment. I think that my semen is strong enough to impregnate any woman. And any woman. That's why I use protection when it comes to Daphna. Because I really don't want to have a baby. Because one little drop, that's it.
The fact that I use protection baffles me.
I have a whole
I respect that. I'm not here to make comments on anyone's relationship. I have... I won't say never, but not for a long time. Like, when I have a girlfriend, the goal is eventually raw sex, I think.
Of course. That's so that's the goal for everybody. It just feels better.
Yeah, no, yeah. Because like, you have a girlfriend, the growing pains, I guess, of the relationship where the trust isn't fully there. You wear condoms and all that stuff. But after a while, it's like, hey, I ran out, and we could not, or we could. And I'll introduce you to my pull-out game.
Yeah.
And then once she sees the extent to which I pull out, we're good. We're straight.
So the moral of the story is, Steven has a mean pull-out
game. Mean.
Mean. Mean machine.
Lean, mean Joe Green.
Yeah. Mean machine. I've never seen you pull out, but I heard
stories. Take my word for it.
I've heard stories from you.
I was going to say, what did you hear stories from?
From you that your pull-out game is fantastic. I mean, I feel like I have a great pull-out game because it's not all the time where I do use props. Sometimes I just take it off because it's just annoying and it hurts me. Because, like, that's too tight. Yeah. Just
can we talk about condoms real quick?
Go ahead. We'll talk about condoms. We'll do that.
Okay. Ladies?
Not real quick. We just talk about it if you want.
Okay, listen, the thing is, and I just want to... Because I see this a lot on Twitter and Tumblr and Facebook. This whole, a condom can fit a whole thing of water. When niggas say that their dick's too big for condoms, they lying to you. Bro.
Condoms tight.
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 I can never wear Durex. Nah,
fucking my last ex. Should I say her name?
If you want to. That's I'm not going to edit it out.
All right, whatever. So my last ex... The first time we have sex is in my house, and my condom, my preferred condom of use is the Skin XLs.
Oh, those are nice.
Yeah.
The lambskins?
Yeah, SKYN.
Oh my
That's
God.
That's my preferred condom of use.
They feel so nice.
Yeah. I feel like latex just feels weird on my junk.
It gets inside.
Yeah.
You feel me? Like, it gets inside your dick.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and sometimes it just... It dries up and it just sticks to your head and you just gotta pull it off.
Yeah. So I usually try not to do magnums. Magnums fit well enough.
I don't like magnums.
I don't like them. I don't like the way they feel.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? The length and the width of whatever, they're fine enough.
Yeah.
They get the job done. But yeah, it just feels weird. Like I said, it just latex feels weird on my junk.
Mm-hmm.
So I use Skins.
Yeah.
The first time she and I had sex, that's what was used. The second time, however, I went to her house, and she had a fishbowl full of Lifestyle condoms.
Ew.
And NYCs.
Ew. Wait,
Lifestyles.
Is Skin Lifestyle brand?
I think Skin is Lifestyle, like, premium brand.
It's a premium brand, yeah. I know, because it's $14 for, like, 3-4 condoms.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember. I bought them because you recommended some, which... I love, but they're way too expensive for condoms.
Yeah.
I'm not going to about to pay $14 just to have...
It got me tight, because after a certain point, like I said, she and I stopped using condoms.
Yeah.
Because we were in a relationship. And she gave all them Skins away to her best friend's boyfriend.
Mm-mm.
And I'm like, yo, them shit is expensive.
Yeah, they Girl. Feel good too. Come yeah, on, just come use them on. As a glove.
Yeah, man, I could wear them to work.
I'm trying to mix these cupcakes together.
Shit.
trying to season these shits. Nah, but those condoms are amazing.
My point is, them Lifestyles, them NYCs, them Trojans, the regular Trojans.
Yeah.
I hate all of them. They feel like a boa constrictor. You know, When you roll out a condom,
yep.
the base end, how it has like a thicker band, that shit feels like it's giving my penis a chokehold. Cupid's chokehold.
Yeah.
Ba-da-da-da. Ba-da-da-da.
Go ahead.
Nah, but yeah, it's a... I just wanted to address that because we're talking about condoms. And yeah. Like I said, I know most of the people who listen to the podcast are my friends. A lot of them girls, some guys.
And a lot of other people who just don't know us.
It's facts. We've been getting people from like California and shit.
Yeah,
thank you.
Texas.
Yeah. Hey.
We got a few people from Russia, which is weird.
Hey, thank you.
Yeah.
I appreciate it. I understand why Russia, because we tag New York Knicks.
Vladimir Putin.
Yeah.
And we tagged a lot of Donald Trump.
Yeah. So I understand why shit like that. But hey, thanks for listening.
Yeah.
Keep listening. We're gonna get better. This is episode 5.
Yes, we are.
I encourage you to look out for episode 50.
We've passed our first month recently. Like, this is our first podcast of a new month.
It's
been a whole month of podcasting.
Cheers, bro.
Yeah, cheers, bro. Seriously, like, let's try that again.
Can you stop saying that word?
No, I'm talking about you. I wouldn't call a female a bitch.
Okay.
Oh, I mean, sorry. I wouldn't call a woman a bitch. Sorry.
I like that you caught yourself.
I caught myself. Ooh, I'm trying to learn to be a...
No, you are.
A way better person you using are. Better I, words.
Vocabulary.
Yeah, yeah, I don't want to be offensive.
The vocabulary that you use matters if it matters to the person that it's being used against.
No, I wouldn't want to call my fiance a female. I wouldn't call my daughter in the future a female either.
The thing is,
they're
like,
women. They're
a lot
strong.
A lot of guys say, oh, but female is just a word. But the way I see it, the way I've expressed this to you, if a woman tells you that she does not like being called female... That's it. Like that should be it. That should be, you should strive to make people feel.
Yeah, the word, I was talking about this with my coworker. Yeah, you know? I was talking about this with my coworker that it's offensive to kind of say female because it sounds like a lesser male.
The problem is that you cannot tell people when they're offended about. You know, like if, and many women, like this is a thing. A lot of women have come out and said, hey, I hate female. Don't like it. Makes me feel like you're calling me a dog.
Yeah.
Or like a non-human.
Mm-hmm.
And guys have, by and large, just been like, no, you're being a sensitive female. No. If a person says they don't like a term, we don't use that term.
Yeah.
We can be good. We can be better people.
We're a progressive podcast. Yeah, we're 25. We're not afraid to, you know, correct ourselves and say when we're wrong.
And it's going to be a journey. You know, like Josh lets the B word slip out. I do too. I'm not going to lie to you. I do too every once in a while. I catch myself though.
Yeah.
I try not. I've got, they come fewer and farther between now. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I appreciate it. I saw you catch yourself. Yeah. Had to give you the quick
myself,
props.
But remember, I called you a bitch.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't take that back.
you still a bitch.
You still a bitch.
Why was I a bitch though?
I don't know. I'll think about it later.
I forgot.
There's a reason why. anyways, we're very progressive podcast.
Now I'm gonna get back to this condom shit real quick. Just let me finish off this condom shit real quick.
Now we're gonna finish it off.
Please, ladies, understand that while a condom will stretch out, and that is true, you can fit a lot of stuff into a condom. It doesn't give you breathing room. Like that's what we're talking about when we say the condom's too tight. We're talking about the breathing room between the penis and the condom.
Mm-hmm.
When you're a guy with an above average size penis, and what's the average? Like 7?
It's actually 5.5. So high five to having above average penis size.
You dead ass?
Yeah, man.
Bro, I done did
my research.
You done did it.
Yeah, because Daphna was asking, and then she asked Amazon, and then it told us 5.5.
So you're telling that most people walking around right now
America,
got a 5.
In America, in the United States, have a 5.5 inch penis, which I thought was way too small to begin with.
I thought that's average.
Yes, average. I thought average was
7.
6.
No, to me, I thought
to
it was
me,
7.
To me, I was 6. See? I thought it was 6. I thought for all my life was 6.
And I'm not
it's
saying
5
I have,
and a half.
I'm not saying I have like a 10-inch dick.
Nah.
Like, please, my dick is, 8 inches.
Okay.
And like if when it's okay, because it depends on the hardness.
Well,
it,
right? I won't be talking about the size of my dick on this podcast.
You're fucking married.
Yeah.
You're engaged to be married, but you're married.
Just know that I haven't been single for a reason.
I'm not out here posting the picture of my dick. I'm just saying 8 inches. Maybe 0.2, 0.3 when it's like OD hard.
Bro, it's a great size for a dick. But the thing is, that compared to an average size penis of the United States, you're talking about like tenfold.
My whole point, no, my point by tenfold exposing my penis size is to say that I never thought that I had, I love my penis. Like my penis and I get along fantastically.
You should love your penis.
But
you should.
He has the job done for me, man. He and I, we're on lockstep. But I never thought that I had like an abnormally huge dick.
Yeah, it's not like it's folding out of your pocket.
Right.
And just
went, right.
And then people just yell at it.
And also like growing up watching porn, and you see them niggas with like the mandingos.
Oh God, it's just like
with the Lexus steels.
It's the, like the size of this tripod.
Yeah, and that shit just gives you a complex. It's like, my dick isn't that big, mm-hmm. So it must not be big.
You ever watched porn back in the days and like, my dick's not that big, or yeah. Like, my dick's kind of like that. Like you just compare your penis to other porn star penises.
Oh,
oh God, Steven, you and the you have terrible luck with beer foam.
So.
You have terrible luck with beer foam.
So this beer just foamed all over my fucking pants.
Yo, that chair has absorbed so much beer. No, stop trying to lick it.
I'm gonna lick it off myself.
No, you can't even reach. It's your pants. It's like sucking your own penis.
I would if I could.
There you go. That's another topic for another
would
day.
You if you could?
Yeah.
Don't fucking bullshit me, bro.
Yeah, I mean, dude, I masturbate.
Yeah.
You know, I touch my shit.
Yeah.
I've been forever.
I just hate that.
If at a young age I learned to suck my own dick, hell yeah. Bro, I would never get my own jizz in my mouth, but I'd be like, I'll just pull out
right.
myself all the time. I don't want to get pregnant.
you gotta be sure. Kids are expensive.
Yeah, man. I don't have that money.
So just ladies, please, to end this dick talk, just going forward, if a man of abnormally or above average penis size says, hey, this condom fits my dick too tight. SKYN. Don't, like, if he says, hey, nah, let's go raw. No. Raw, like, that's safe for someone you trust.
Yes. That's, you trust someone, you don't use a condom with someone you absolutely
please,
trust.
Please, and get tested before.
Uh-huh, of course.
Practice safe sex. Don't let a nigga trick you into condom-free sex.
Saying that I'm allergic and shit
and
like
I'm
that.
I'm allergic. Yeah,
like, there's non-latex condoms.
Listen, that is the case. Some people are allergic to latex.
Yeah, but there's non-latex condoms.
But there are non-latex condoms. Like I said, skin, S-K-Y-N,
lambskin.
Lambskin,
which... Ladies, it feels amazing.
It feels amazing. It's almost like it's nothing there.
It's expensive, but it's gorgeously
well,
amazing
you know what?
In your penis.
You know what?
On your penis, in your vagina.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
It's in your penis. Is that what you said?
Yo, imagine.
That doesn't sound pleasant.
No, that's like...
I mean, that would definitely work as birth control, right? Because it's like it's going to capture all the cum.
Oh, of course. But then you have a backup of jizz inside of your shaft.
That's a UTI.
Yep. That's there you go, infection. UTI, there you go. Back to yeast infections.
Yo, we really talk about yeast infections too much on this podcast.
We did twice, today's
this
the twice.
Third time.
But
this
the
third
thing
time.
Is... Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember I was... Because I listen to our podcast a lot, because I'm really... I don't know, is that snobby?
No, it's not. It's like when Lana Del Rey listens to her music. It's just her music. She gets to listen to it. She does
a
choice.
I think we're funny, dude. I think... I don't know. I haven't heard one bad thing about our podcast yet.
Me neither.
And the thing is, like, listen, some of the people I asked are, I can admit that they'd be the kind of person that even if they didn't like it, they'd say they liked it.
Yeah.
But a lot of the people I've asked are genuine people.
Mm-hmm.
The kind of people who are like, I don't like that. And they'll tell me.
Yeah.
And that's the kind of person I prefer.
I mean.
Just as a FYI. Guys and gals, whoever's listening to this podcast, when dealing with mirrors, speaking to myself in the third person. Go speaking ahead. About
myself in the third person. You're already reaching that type of level.
Yeah.
Of human beingism.
Human beingism.
Yeah. Is that a good beer, by the way?
I feel like it's going to foam. And I'm really scared.
It foams a little bit. Talk.
Yeah. I like the truth. I prefer the truth. I like a harsh truth more than a dishonest, easy lie.
Yeah.
The reason being is I want to be the best version of myself. I'm almost obsessed with like bettering myself. I want to find out if I'm doing something wrong. I need to know that thing. You're doing me no favors by allowing me to continue doing something that I shouldn't be doing. So if you're telling me, if you think this podcast is ass, you're a liar, first of all. But if you think, let a nigga know. Slide, yeah, hey, man. Hey, you guys talked about dicks too much in that one podcast.
Yeah, just let us know. We like criticism.
I love criticism. I really do.
It makes us better. If it makes us better, then we're just going to have better results. And that's how that works. You know, it's not like we listen to one person and that one person just degrades our podcast. We're not going to do that. Yeah. If there's a majority saying that our podcast fucking sounds like ass, we're going to listen to that and we're going to make the best of it.
It's like if your man's dick's game is weak and his stroke game is just, there's no rhythm to it.
Mm-mm.
It's kind of long like, strokes, short strokes, short strokes, long strokes, short
strokes. It's just short half, strokes the whole time. Just.
I mean, depending on how you short stroke, you can get some. There's some effectiveness
now to be having. Not forever.
Not forever. There's no, but combo. It's depending, bro.
You gotta learn. Learn your combos.
Okay.
Like fucking Street Fighter. Like
you gotta roll the hips, bro. Just roll the hips. Boom.
I wish there was video.
I'm demonstrating right now.
Legit, I'm rolling his hips in front of me.
Just roll the hips.
I'm never gonna sit in that chair again.
This is your computer chair.
Yeah.
You tight.
Nope.
You're doing him no favors by fake moaning.
Oh yes, please
don't girls, fake moan. Don't girls, fake moan.
The thing is, what I love, if a girl, don't fake it. Just tell me what you want.
Don't be like, nah, nigga, you suck, you trash, get off me. Be just like, hey, a little higher, a little lower, just like that. Positive reinforcement, and it benefits you. I'm not saying hey for his ego. I'm saying it does you no fun to have trash sex, right? Like I hate having trash sex.
Oh, it's bad. It's bad.
Trash sex is trash. It's trash.
Yeah, you don't want to have that because if you're a woman, you can say, "Hey."
This goes for guys as well. If she's using too much teeth,
oh,
let her know. Oh, I don't bro, let her know. Don't like insult her.
No, like ooh, babe.
You're like, oh, baby, I like when you use your lips a little more. I like
ooh,
the way
babe.
You. You know, like
a little
like
teeth, please.
Wrap your.
It's
your,
awesome,
your lip
but
around your
my
teeth.
My God, this little teeth in there is kind of just. You're doing great.
Some guys like teeth.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not. I'm just saying you and I.
I'm just saying no. I'm just saying that. I'm saying that it's a preference thing.
Mm-hmm.
It also you what works with one person may not work at all with another person, which is why like this guy could be going off a handbook that he had with his previous partner that worked. Like he's just checking off all the check boxes. Like, yeah, she like this, she like that. And you enjoy none of those things.
Yeah.
Now, is he wrong? No. Are you wrong? No. But neither of you know how you truly feel. So you're both just doing what you know.
Yeah, you're just
and
learning.
Nothing is happening.
Well, sex is a learning game, especially with the people that you're in a relationship with and you're intimate with. You know, you're constantly learning their kinks and they're constantly learning your kinks.
Yeah.
So you're learning each other. And then when it gets good, oh, God, it gets great.
That's the thing. That's the thing. It's that, listen, when there's openness and communication in sex. Lordy.
Ooh-wee. It's fun. It's going to be a limited volcano explosion. Yeah. It's just great.
Yeah.
It's crazy. And then when you learn that, you start developing new techniques with each other. And it's an awesome thing.
Like, okay, this is a personal story. I didn't tell you this. You're about to find out something that the podcast is about to find out at the same time. We're doing this.
I wonder who's the better friend.
Huh? No, it's a personal thing. It's a... You know, I've been single for about a month and a half now.
Go ahead.
Guys.
Just tell me anyway.
All right. So, my ex and I, had sex. You know, everyone has their thing that they're best at. My thing that I think that I'm best at is eating, like cunnilingus.
Yeah.
Like that's my specialty. And 9 times out of 10, I got you. Like, I'm gonna make you come. I couldn't with my ex, with my most recent. At first, I could not. That's because she liked different motion, different tongue motions.
Yeah, she's just.
And I was just doing what I thought worked, what I had success with previously.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't working. And I was like, "Hey, so, guide me.
Yeah.
Tell me what you like. Enjoy." And every time since then, boom, you know?
Yeah, boom, pow.
I got to have a conversation. You got to have a conversation. Don't be afraid of being incorrect, of being wrong.
Of course.
Because you're only going to know that you're wrong by admitting that you're wrong and correcting it.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's the only way you're going to be right. Because if you just pout and be like, oh, you're just going to keep being wrong. You guys are going to keep having trash sex. One of you is going to cheat on each other, on the other, and you guys are going to break up.
Mm-hmm. It's like a sports game, you know? You're not perfect at the first beginning. And even if you're a veteran...
You might be. Don't get me wrong. There are times where I've had sex with someone for the first time, and...
And just you just hit a home run right away? You're like Aaron Judge?
Yeah. My point is... It's the point that I'm trying to get across is everyone... What people like is different.
Everyone has their own kinks.
Some people like having their clits slapped. Some girls don't like that at all. You just communication. Communication is key.
Body communication and also
it just depends.
Just talk to each other.
It just depends on your point of view.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of points of view, it's time for Song of the Week.
Woo! Song of the Week.
Song of the Week.
Do I have a song for you?
I'm gonna go first because you're gonna see my transition here.
Yeah, go ahead. Since you already planned it ahead of time.
My song of the week is POV again by Division. Oh, DVSN.
Damn.
Yeah.
If you haven't noticed yet, he's a big fan.
Nah, listen. I'm not gonna do a different Division song every fucking week.
I feel like there's gonna be a time where you're gonna do a different Division song every week.
Next Friday, October the 13th. Like I said, this is October 8th. We're recording this at 7:31 p.m. currently. I don't know why you need to know that, but now you do.
Nope. There you go. If you listen this far,
October 13th. The new Division album called Morning After comes out. Every week he's been releasing a new song. So every week I've been falling in love with a new song of theirs. It would be disingenuous of me to just be like, oh no, this is the song of the week, when it isn't. When in my heart, POV is the song of the week.
So POV, short for
point of view.
Point of view, yeah.
And that's why I said it depends on your point of view. It's a sex song.
Yeah, of course. It's Division.
Yeah. His music is very sex oriented, but it's not the regular old I put a Molly in her drink and she likes snorting mad coke and we gon' fuck and your girl thought and you don't know it. It's sensual. It's mood music. It's the kind of music that you lay your girlfriend down to. And you just give her the fucking work, bro. Just the... You out here.
Okay.
Yeah. So, Morning After, October 13th. The name of the song is POV. My good sir?
Mm-hmm. My song of the week is from a new band that no one absolutely knows, and I feel like that's gonna be my thing, introducing bands that I listen to that probably not a lot of people have listened to, especially in our Bronx area or anywhere.
Who does that a lot is I listen to a lot of podcasts, so I feel like our podcast is a jambalaya. A sancocho.
Yo, that sounds good.
A sancocho of sorts. Of different things different podcasts do that I enjoy, that and shit that we enjoy, makes us our podcast. Yes. Joe Budden has the podcast called, I'll name it podcast later, or I guess it's called the Joe Budden podcast now because he switched the name. Mm-hmm. He has a sleeper section, and what he does is he and his two co-hosts, every week they drop a song. They don't drop a song. They put you onto a song,
yes,
that you may not have heard of.
Mm-hmm.
It's a sleeper.
That's nice. Yeah. Well, I'm gonna.
So that's what you're gonna be.
Yeah, doing. I'm gonna be that sleeper guy because my favorite thing in the world is
putting people onto
honestly,
music.
Honestly, is putting people onto music. I feel like I've been doing that since forever. Right. But at the same time, that's what I enjoy. Is every day I'll listen to a discovered playlist, or I'll just look at who released a new album, or an album or artist that's related to another artist. And today, I'm gonna put you on to a song called "Have Faith" by a band called Palace. Palace is it's a band also.
Now, Palace is spelled
P-A-L-A-C-E. Yeah, like Palace. Yeah. Yes.
They're some people are bad spelling.
Yeah, I know. They're a UK band, and they're alternative indie rock. They have I would say their style would be a lot like the Boxer Rebellion.
Yeah, I was about to say, UK artists have been killing,
yes,
bro.
When it comes to that so kind of
that
like indie, rock indie
now, that
field.
Indie, you got fucking the Boxer Rebellion. Yeah. Name of this band, Palace.
Uh-huh.
You got my homie Sampha.
Uh-huh. You got my last name, Wolf Alice, what I mentioned last podcast.
What would you say Sam Smith is kind of indie, or would you say he's
no,
pop?
I would say that he's very popish, but he is hardcore.
It's
UK.
Weird.
He comes
it's,
straight from there.
It's, yeah, it's because he is, I'm not disagreeing with you, he's absolutely pop, but it's a weird pop.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's not like a Nick Jonas pop.
No, he's soulful. He's
soulful
in the same
pop,
genre,
you know?
Of like Adele, of like
I'd
Amy Winehouse.
I liken him to. I would say that he is Justin Timberlake meets Sampha.
No, I'm gonna say right. I'm gonna give you the comparison right now.
Lay it
on. He's Adele versus.
His music's much more listenable than Adele's.
Adele, listen to me, brother. Adele versus Adele versus John Lennon. John Lennon. John Legend.
Legend. Yeah.
Ha-ha.
I know
John
what you were
Legend.
Saying. No, I know what you were
not
saying.
Not John Lennon. He died.
Yeah.
John Legend. Mm. Yes. He's a good mix of those. John Legend with his kind
mine.
Of soulful. His soulful, you know.
Say I'm crazy.
Yeah.
Keep going.
But then you have Adele, which is also a native of the United Kingdom. And she has a very, very, very soulful voice. And she sings a lot about love and breakup. Which is Sam Smith. And I feel like they know each other for somehow. But yeah, let's not get too far with Sam Smith and Adele.
He's coming out with a new album as well.
Yeah, he is. He definitely is.
I don't know. I don't remember the name of the song particularly, but it was something about that he's used to just getting over people. And it's a good song. I'm a fan of Sam Smith.
Yeah, just go back. Yep. Just let it load.
It's called "Too Good at Goodbyes."
Yes, that
by
one.
Sam Smith.
Yeah, we had to search it. But
go
it
play that
quick.
Out. It's not a song of the week at all. It's just a song I recommend.
Yeah, it's a good song. We were listening to it when we were eating our salads.
Yeah,
yeah. But my
God
damn it! Say
that motherfucking damn it!
Ah! But your yeah, song. Please listen to "Have Faith" by Palace. It'll play in the background anyway. But this band's. Their new album, which came out this year, called So Long Forever, is their first LP.
Oh, I love that.
It's their first LP from many, many EPs.
It's a breakup album. You can tell by that.
It's a lot of albums. They released a lot
so
of...
So Long Forever?
Yeah.
That's
like forever, for
like
Emma
a so
forever
long to a relationship. Yeah, like forever, forever ago.
Yeah, which
it's like
by
a,
Bon Iver.
Like we said this would be forever, and we broke up. It's So Long Forever. I really like that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man. I feel a poem coming on. I might write a poem about
he's
that
gonna
concept.
He's going to go home and write a poem.
I write poetry sometimes, guys. Yeah. I don't ever release it.
We all do.
Yeah, but you released. I feel like you released. I am. I don't have a problem with my sensitivity.
Same here.
I say that a lot. I'm very open about the fact. Like, a lot of people do the thing like, oh, cancers are so sensitive. So? No, so like, what, listen, like, bro? Fucking, we're human beings. Human beings have a very wide range of emotions. I personally feel that when you try to shut those emotions off, you make yourself less of a human.
Yeah.
Like, you're supposed to have that range of emotions. You're just supposed to know how to control them better, how to deal them.
Exactly. But someone who feels, you know, that they're pretty much normal.
Yeah, yeah. You shouldn't fucking hide from your emotions. Uh-uh. So, for any motherfucker out there listening to this, you call me emotional, you call me sensitive, I'm going to be like, yeah. Yeah, I am.
Yes, I am.
Yeah, I am.
I'm not emo.
Like, that's another thing. Like, I feel sad. I feel sad. I get sad. I'm not much of a crier. It's not something I brag about. I'm not saying, like, hey, I'm not much of a crier, so I'm tough. I just don't really, like, cry. Or, like, get super down on myself like that.
No, I mean, it's good to have emotions. Don't try to block out your emotions. Don't run from your emotions. Please.
Cry. Crying is healthy. I actually wish I cried more. Because I know that when I do cry, I feel shitty at the moment, but so much better afterwards.
Oh, it's a nice thing. Like, yeah, don't bottle up your problems. Don't bottle up your fears.
Feel
them out.
Feel your talk. Unless it's anger and it's toxic, you should also not. Just make sure that you having your emotional escape isn't becoming a hindrance on someone else and giving them emotional baggage. Josh has dropped a whole bunch of candy corn.
I like candy corn, guys. I know a lot of people don't like candy corn. I
hate that shit, bro.
I know a lot of people don't like candy corn, but I love candy corn. This is why I like October.
You're about to negate all the progress from Saturday.
It's fine.
Saturday, which was, again, yesterday. So today is Sunday. October 8th.
Yes.
We went to the gym. So, like I said, Josh and I go to separate gyms. We're both on a fitness journey. We're taking different roads. And honestly, bro, yesterday, if it showed anything to me, is that I feel like we should go to the gym together more often.
I agree, because we technically do better.
Yeah, okay. So, when I go to the gym, it's, most of the time, it's by myself. But I also go with my ex-girlfriend's brother's close friend happens to go to that gym. One day I ran into him. He's like, hey, work out with me. This guy is in a lot better physical shape than I. And so he really pushed me. I love working out with him because those are my best workouts. Now, I took that style of working out. And yesterday I went to the workout with Josh and his brother.
Mm-hmm.
And I pushed them the way I'm used to being pushed. And I could see, like they didn't even know that they can go as far as they did go.
Yeah.
And because of that, and seeing you guys push yourselves pushed me.
Like, in the words of my brother, watching you guys work out made me feel good. Made me want to do more.
Yeah.
Because he watched us, like, we're used to working out with each other. We haven't done it in a while till yesterday. But we used to all the time work out, like, constantly together. And we know each other's chemistry when it comes to working out. We know what's our positives, our negatives, weaknesses. But he's never seen that. Mm-hmm. And seeing that, he's seen what it would look like to be great. And that's what you and I do. We push each other to become great.
I work so well off of competition. Mm-hmm. I'm a competitive person, but again, it's, I'm just a real nigga, bro. Like, your progress does not offend me at all. I know a lot of people get offended, they get bothered, they feel jealousy. Like, they see someone progressing and they're like, oh, that could be me, that should be me. This shit just motivates me.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm working out with someone, when I'm doing anything and I see someone doing better than me, my first instinct is to study that person, see what they do, see how I can apply it to my own thing and become better.
Yeah.
I have almost an addiction to just becoming the best version of myself. I'm really curious. Because the thing is, like, I think I'm a really smart guy. I think I'm talented. I think I'm multi-talented. This sounds like a brag. I'm not trying to brag. This is a genuine thing. Like, I genuinely believe these things. And I'm really curious as to what my peak is. And for a really long time, I struggled with, like, procrastination and shit. And I'm finally... And I guess that, like, that may have been tied to my depression and all that. But yeah. Now that I'm peeling back the layers of my depression and feeling more like myself, I'm discovering that I'm more capable than I ever really thought that I was. So right now, my whole thing is I'm curious just to see how capable I am.
And I've always told this to myself, that I know that Steven is capable of taking over the world. It's just he doesn't know how to. Or there's just a lot of things
I'm just really hard on myself.
Yeah, there's just a lot of things that get in the way of Steven. And I've seen Steven... I've seen mirrors develop into this kind of person that pushes himself into his limits. And that's a great thing to look at as a best friend, because you don't ever want to see your best friend just plateau. You want to see them skyrocket. You want to see them be the best version of themselves. And I feel like when you say there's a peak, I don't feel like there's a peak. I feel like you can. I feel like you'll find a peak, and then you just jump on that peak and find a new peak.
I'm curious to see what a peak is, though.
Yeah.
The thing is, my whole life, I'm the first of five. Backstory is gonna get kind of weird, I guess. First of five, I felt a lot of pressure growing up because my mom was a single mom, and I was first of three in my household. My dad was just a scumbag. And had two other kids out of wedlock. But they exist, so first of five. First of three in my household, though, as I was saying. I was expected to kind of be like the father. Now that my dad wasn't around. And this responsibility was placed on me at the age of nine. You know? Like, at the age of nine, my dad left and I, like, had to get a job. Bagging groceries. I tell people that and they like, bugged out. Like, I deadass been working since I was nine.
Yeah, you know, a lot of people think that's crazy. Like, oh, you've been working since you were a young kid. Nah,
I had to. Yeah, I had to. And then my first paycheck when I was nine, I worked bagging groceries at a supermarket, C-Town, in Burnside. C-Town. For people who live around
C-Town, the Bronx. Yeah,
it's like right up, right at the bottom of the hill when you're going up into Burnside.
Exit away from Fordham.
So I worked bagging groceries, and my first paycheck, I remember, it was, like, depressing. Like, and I couldn't say it, because I know my mom needed it. I was always kind of, like, a emotionally intelligent kid in the way that, like, I was good at picking up how people felt. And with my first pay, my mom took my money and, like, bought my siblings sneakers. And I hated that. And I could tell she didn't want to. But I resented that so much.
Yeah, because you earned that money.
Yeah, at the same time, like, I knew I had to. So I didn't fight it. You know, I was like, all right, here, mom. You need it. And I could tell she really didn't want to. And that was a really low point in her life. Like, because she made me go work, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But only because she needed me to. Like, if she didn't, she didn't even know how she was going to pay her rent. That kind of shit... And I was at the age of nine. That kind of shit pushed me to kind of super expectations thing.
Yeah.
Where my mom kind of expected me to just be the man. Yeah. And I never let go of that. So my whole life I've had really crazy expectations of myself. Mm-hmm. And whenever I see that I'm not, like, meeting them, I give up.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, that's not for me. I should be great at it. If I'm not great at it from the beginning,
why am I doing it? Yeah. And like I said, I've seen that a lot in you for the past few years. Ever since you started a slave at the job and stuff. And I'm like, you know what? Steven's better than this. And I know that one day, like, no one else can push Steven like this, the way Steven does. The way Mirrors does. That's the only person that can push Mirrors is Mirrors. And it's been happening. It's been happening, and this is why we have the podcast. Yeah. If he never pushed himself, believe me, this wouldn't be on the air. Episode one wouldn't even start.
Yeah.
And it's, I mean, like we said, we've tried this in the past, but...
A little backstory, yeah.
Yeah, we tried this in the past, but it never really worked out because of Steven.
Because of me, yeah. Because we recorded 3 episodes before episode one, and every episode I found the problem with it. I was like, it's not perfect, we can't release it. And Josh is like, nah, man, it's good enough. Let's just release it. And I'm like, no, it's not good. It's just not to my standard. And he's like, but what's your standard? We gotta start from somewhere.
Yeah, exactly.
And I couldn't let go of that. Like I said, I've done a lot of working on myself. I've done a lot of accepting that perfection isn't something that you just land into.
Yeah.
It's something you work towards.
Mm-hmm.
And here we are, episode 5.
Exactly. Like, you can tell that kind of, like, renaissance thinking from episode 1, where we didn't even have an intro track, where our audio in the beginning was pretty much just shaky and we were nervous, mm-hmm. to episode 5, where I barely even have to fucking edit because we're so great at talking and we're great at this. And I feel like that we've come to that point, and I feel like it didn't need to take that long. We're episode 5 weeks in this. Do you know
why? Like, for me personally, the problem was with episode 1 or the episodes prior to episode 1, I was thinking of it as like recording a podcast.
Yeah.
That's where the nerves kicked in.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was somewhere along... Episode 3 is really my favorite episode we've recorded so far.
Yeah.
I think it was around that time where I was like, I'm literally just having a conversation with my best friend.
Yeah.
I do this all the time.
Uh-huh.
So like, it got to a point where, like I said, for episode 1, maybe episode 2, I was like staring at Ableton. I was like hyper aware of the computer, hyper aware of the mics,
yeah,
and everything. Now, episode 5, again, we're not super far in, but already I'm barely paying attention to the mics. I don't care.
We don't
I'm just having a conversation with my best friend, you know?
Yes, and that's what the podcast should be. Yeah. The podcast, and that's what I've been trying to like stress since the beginning, since before episode 1 when we were trying to start this up, is that this should not just be... This shouldn't be something that we have to be so critical about. Yeah. We have to be so nervous about. This is literally just having a great time with your best friend, bro, just talking.
It's like, it's something that we started doing for fun. So it's something that we should be having fun while doing.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. We should always have fun. Yeah. Regardless of what this takes us in the future, we should always have fun.
We're getting a TV show, baby.
I mean, if it happens, it happens.
Also, but at
the same time, this shit should be fun all the time. And that's what I want. I want to work where I'm enjoying myself, where I'm enjoying our company, where I'm enjoying the fun,
yeah.
Where it gets stressful. But at the same time, I'd rather have the stress than what I had before.
Let me tell you this. And again, like, there's no one I would rather be doing this with. I want to say that. I feel like you spoke some very kind words about me,
mm-hmm.
a couple minutes ago.
Yeah, of course.
I want to reiterate. I want to reciprocate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I feel you do a really good job at pushing me in a way I don't feel like forced.
Yeah.
That it's like a natural, just like a go on. Mm-hmm. Go on, you got this. It's like I'm not saying you're my father.
Yeah.
You know, I have father issues. I don't have a father.
Yeah. No,
it's like when a father pushes you, when you're riding the training wheels on a bike, he takes the training wheels off and you're scared, and he gives you a light little shove. Like,
yeah, hey. He's like, he's holding your shoulders. He's like, you got it.
And then he lets
you got it. And then slowly just lets go. Yeah. Positive reinforcement.
I feel like you've positive reinforced me. A lot in life, but specifically with this podcast.
Yeah,
and I want to say I appreciate you for that.
Thank you. Like I said, man, you're my brother. You know, your life. And I only want to see the best for you. But at the same time, I feel like together we can only achieve greatness. Not always achieve greatness.
Every
but
single
only,
fucking time.
Only
every single fucking time.
Greatness.
Bro, I have an almost... what's the word? It's almost cocky how much I believe in us.
Yeah,
Like, I just seriously think we got this.
Oh, we got it, man.
I don't know.
Like I said, the reviews that I've read, the reviews that I've heard from different people, not even family, is very positive. And it's just episode 4.
Hey,
we're doing also, episode 5
keep
now.
In mind, Josh and I work really well off of compliments.
Yeah, we do.
Send them reviews.
No, we do. We do.
Rate, comment, subscribe.
We do read
the
bad thoughts, stuff. Yeah. Yeah, we do get the bad thoughts, and then we. I want to come criticizing. We like the criticism.
No, that's we love compliments, but we love criticism for another reason. And I touched into that a little earlier, where I said I have an almost of an addiction with finding out how good I can be as a person. Just in general, like any facet of humanity. I want to see what my limits are.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I've been living far beneath my limits for the first 25 years of my life. And I'm entirely done with that.
Yeah.
So the next 25 years of my life, I'm just going to try to figure out how good are you? You've been talking all this shit for so long, Miraz, about how you're super smart,
No, that your pullout game
how
is perfect.
Care, how you care, you're a caring, loving person. How caring, how loving, how smart, how charismatic are you? Show me.
All you can prove is your pullout game.
I could prove my pullout game. I'm not gonna prove it to everybody though.
You're like, look at me.
Nah, I'm not gonna prove it to anyone. But you know, like my pullout game's strong.
I feel like, but the thing is, going back to the topic, I feel like we together, only together, can achieve greatness.
Yeah.
And you being on top of your game, and me pushing you to be the best you can, and you pushing me the best I can, like we did with the gym yesterday, we could take over the fucking world.
Now, I want to ask you one more question before I leave, because I feel like we started off on the fitness thing, went into like a mutual love thing, which I appreciate, man.
Hey
man, I always want you to know that I care about you.
Yeah,
I know you always want me to know that that you care about me.
Mm-hmm.
But to jump back into the subject, what are your fitness goals?
My fitness goals, honestly, to get a solid six pack, to be as healthy as possible, honestly, and to gain like 10 more pounds in pure muscle. Honestly,
yeah.
It's pure muscle. I want to look great. I want to like take off. Like I feel comfortable taking off my shirt. Like I'm in good shape as I am now, but I want to be in like amazing fucking shape. Like I'm just like I just don't want to wear a shirt.
Yeah, I get, you know I've said similar things before. In the past. I'm having a little bit of a conundrum as to what my fitness goals are. I started off 286 pounds.
Mm-hmm.
I am now 240 pounds.
That's so fucking great.
46, 45. Who's to say? But I don't know, man. My initial goal, anyone you talk to will tell you that my goal is to look like Khal Drogo from
Game of Thrones. Yeah.
I can't remember his actual name.
Don't worry.
Jason Momoa.
There you go. Yes. Jason Momoa. That's actually Daphne's crush.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I can't ever look like that.
I think I can because I'm like a pretty wide. Yeah. I'm like I have broad shoulders and all that stuff. Well, I think I can. But like, I don't know if I'd mind having like some guts still. I guess my goal is, and I'm inching a lot closer towards it, I guess. Today, I had to run like 2 blocks to catch the bus. I finished running and I was not out of breath at all.
Good.
And I felt, because that shit would have winded me.
Yeah.
That shit would have, like again, I was 280 something pounds, 286 pounds.
You know what impressed me the most?
What?
Yesterday when you did the push-ups.
Oh yeah. Right after doing like mad weightlifting, Josh was like, hey, do push-ups if you can't. Mind you, I was never really good at push-ups.
Yeah.
Josh was like, if you can, it's fine. Don't worry about it, bro. Knocked out like 17 of them real quick.
Nah,
like,
his first set, he did 20. And I'm like, bro, your form is perfect. You got it. And he just knocked them out like nothing. And I'm like, I remember when you couldn't do like 5.
Yeah.
You couldn't do 5, yeah. And you're just knocking out 20 out of nowhere.
But this is, again, that's fitness goals. It's to say, like, I'm very curious to see where I am this summer. Because, like, you almost wouldn't recognize me if you knew me 2 years ago and you know me now, or even if you knew me last year and you knew me now. I'm just a much more motivated, focused person.
Mm-hmm.
I see the things that I allow to be my reality are now just, like, I don't allow them into my life at all. Just the things that allowed, that made me angry, that made me sad, that made me feel like I was less of a fucking god.
Yeah. Nah, you should always.
I love, highly respect yourself, brother. I love myself. Like, I tell people that, and they, like, a lot of people, when I tell them that, they laugh, which is weird a little. Yeah. It was like, what's funny?
What's funny about loving yourself?
Yeah, like,
what's
wrong with you? Like, I wasn't joking. Like, I genuinely do. But I know that a lot of people have a problem with confidence.
Yeah,
I get that.
Yeah, of course.
A couple weeks ago, and I still have weight to lose. I still have a stomach. And stuff.
Progress. Progress is a working game.
But like yesterday, my mom. Okay, guys. My mom. This has been a frustrating thing, but it's. She's moving out this week. My mom and siblings have been living in my apartment for the past month, which has been a true test.
Yeah.
On my mental stability, because I love my family with all of my being. If you're any bit close to me, you know that about me. My mom and I. Insanely close. My sister and I, not as close as we used to be, but we're getting there. My brother and I, also very insane close. And they've been living with me. And yesterday, my mom's like, hey, go check the mail, because she's been getting some of her mail sent to my apartment. And I'm like, all right, whatever. I go out, and I'm wearing sweats and sandals.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, you're not going to put a shirt on? And I was like, for what? And I swear, that's the first time I ever left my house without a shirt.
That's some good shit. That's when you know you feel good about
yourself.
Yeah,
bro.
It's like,
what the fuck?
Shirt's too far.
Yeah,
you just walk out of the house and just check your mail.
I'm gonna let people look at these impressive muscles.
You never seen triceps like those triceps.
You never seen triceps like these?
Triceps,
I just
biceps.
Flexed, guys.
Yeah, like I said, if there was any type of visual thing, you would just see.
You guys would see how much
shit.
Of a fucking dork I am.
Yeah. Yeah. You expect this big guy, but he's like tiny.
Yeah. No, I tell people that all the time. No, I tell people that all the time, because the thing is, I have resting bitch face. Which is
yeah.
Which is like, I look tight all the fucking time, bro. And it doesn't help. Like, I'm, like I said, I'm a wide set guy, and I don't mean like I don't mean body fat wise. I just mean like I have broad shoulders, and I have like a wider frame.
Yeah, he's just,
even if I like was super skinny, I'd just have a wide frame.
He's just meant to be Superman.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate that.
I'm just saying, you got a wide stance on you.
So always look upset, and a pretty 6'2", pretty wide guy. Everyone thinks I'm like a soup, like a dick all the time. And then when you get to know me, I'm like,
yeah, you're like a fucking dork.
I'm a dork. I really
yeah,
am.
Yeah, it's
I
the
really
guy
am.
Who loves Assassin's Creed, who plays video games at his home.
I mean,
he's
I play
not.
2K all day. I watch basketball.
That's
a lot.
Your new thing.
That's my new thing. Yeah.
But when basketball isn't around,
oh, I haven't played Assassin's Creed in a while.
The new game's coming out.
Yeah.
You'll get on to I heard that's going to be a really good game.
Yeah, because they finally took time off.
Yeah, and they finally took time to make a better game, which I appreciate very much, which you will appreciate very much, and which I will appreciate very much, because those games sucked.
They really did.
I hated them.
Well, anyway.
Yeah.
This has been the Bronx Project Podcast.
Uh-huh.
We are your hosts. I am Mirez.
And I'm Earl Grey.
And see you guys next week.
I'll switch my name.